bless God for New Genesis.
Based on something we do or not do, but on everything that he does for us, his desire and his passion for us. So I want to call your attention to two passages of scripture. One is very familiar. Matter of fact, I want to encourage you not to turn off the radio before you hear the message, because this passage is so simple, so familiar. If you have been around Christendom, around the church, or around anybody who knows Yeshua for any measure of time, this passage will be familiar to you. That passage is found in the Gospel of John, the 3rd chapter and the 16th verse. That will be our preaching passage for this morning. And then we're going to go to Romans chapter 5 and verse 8 as our collateral passage. If you don't mind, if you're not physically unable, I'm going to ask you to rest on your feet with me as we honor God in the reading of his word. John chapter number 3, verse number 16. Very familiar chapter. So familiar that we can even recite it without looking in the word. John 3:16. When you have it, let me hear you say amen.
Amen.
I'm going to be coming from the King James Version of the Word, the Bible. Let's read together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but what? Have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Let's go to Romans chapter 5 and verse number 8. Romans 5 and verse 8. And it reads, but God did what? Commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Pray with me. Yahweh, the hour is come again, that your Son, Yeshua, whom we call Jesus, must be lifted up. Jesus said, and if I be lifted up, I, Jesus, will draw all men, all women, all boys, and all girls unto me. So lift Yeshua up again. Today, may Yeshua be seen clearly. May Yeshua be heard and understood without any ambiguity. And when this experience shall have come to a pause, may Yeshua be honored. May Yeshua be obeyed. For thine is the kingdom, thine is the power, thine is the glory forever. And the people of God says, amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We had, Yahweh has blessed us. We have some new people joining the community of our church, and Sister Ernie, which was in the praise team today. Amen. I told her, I said, Sister Ernie, when she transferred her membership, and she did it during the COVID virtual worship experience. So those of you who don't know her, I want you to get to meet her. And her dear husband is here. I thought he played for the New Orleans Brothers. Tall, good looking. Yeah, I thought he was a basketball player. But he
to me and told me who his wife was. I think he has a little possessive going on there. But we're glad to have him with us. And then we had two young men who came and became a part of our worship experience last Sabbath. And before they left, after the service, they made a commitment. Hallelujah. That said, we just moved here from Jersey, but we're not looking for another church. We found our church. Amen. Yeah. Jordan and Isaiah. Did I? Frank. Okay, Frank. Frank. Okay, Frank and Isaiah. What did I get Jordan from? I guess when you think about Isaiah, you got to think about the Jordan River. You know? But the Orwell is going to be working with our media team. And the other one is going to be working with our youth praise team. So watch out, Baton Rouge. Amen. Green is on its way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the time allotted to us to share the Word of God this morning, I want to share with us from the topic, a God-sized love. A God-sized love. Beloved, if you have spent any meaningful time in Paul's letter to the church at Rome, or in the Gospel of John, the disciple, the beloved disciple of Yeshua, you will not be able to leave those two scripture settings without concluding that the salient theme of Paul's letter to the Church of Rome and of John's gospel is the magnanimous, incomprehensible love of Yahweh. I wish somebody was listening to me. Paul's letter to the Church of Rome, Romans, and John's gospel, the fourth gospel, recorded by John, tells us something unique about God's interaction with humanity. And this unique interaction is based on a God-sized love. Mm-hmm. Okay. A God-sized love. A God-sized love. This is a love, beloved, that mankind cannot really comprehend. We cannot really grasp it. We cannot really understand it, Sister Jones said. So it is difficult for us to respond adequately to it. The love of God. This love that causes God to take off his divinity, clothe himself in humanity, allow himself to be incubated in the womb of a teenage Jewish girl for 9 months, to be born in a filthy manger, to allow himself to grow up on the dusty streets of Nazareth. The God of the universe to allow mankind to manhandle him. spitting his face, beating on his back, nail him to a cross. I'm talking about the God who spoke to nothing, reached back into nowhere, pulled forth a hand full of nothing, and when he flunked it into nowhere, nowhere and nothing became this vast universe. God who said, let there be. And before he could complete saying, let there be, when he ordered, let every possibility of becoming something reach and rush to the fall to be whatever God desired it to become before it became it. I wish somebody was
listening.
This God who reached into dust and dirt, and with his own hand decided he was going to create, no, not speak into existence what he did to trees and the waters and the plants and the birds and the cattle, but he was going to mold himself, make a creature that will reflect his very self, breathe into him and her the breath of life. And this creature stood up with all wisdom and understanding, clarity of mind, and God gave him dominion over all of his creation. And this creature sold God out. This creature betrayed the confidence, the trust, and the authority that God placed in him. Yet, God did not destroy this creature. God did not turn his back on this creature. But God decided he will punish himself. Have mercy. In the place of this disobedience, disrespectful, incompliant creature. It's a love that you and I can never comprehend. We can never understand it, and so we can never fully appreciate it and adequately respond to it.
Okay.
The Greeks help us. Got a Landry with some sense of this word love. They give us four distinct words and meaning of this simple word we call love. Break it down for us to be able to understand and appreciate it. Three of them are words that we human can fully relate to. We can comprehend it because it has everything to do with our selfish and self-centered desires. It has everything to do with reciprocity. What's in it for me? When you and I think about love, my friends, we're always thinking from the perspective of what's in it for me. Isn't that the reason why marriages do not last anymore? Relationships are torn apart because it's always about what's in it for me. The first word, the proshay that the Greeks give us is that word eros. Somebody say eros. Eros is another word for love, but it is a word that describes a romantic love, erotic love. And this love is really a love that is based on what's in it for the lover. Okay, okay, come with me, come with me. I see Miss Sharon Wheeler. And the first time I laid my eyes on her, I don't see her for what I can give her, but I see her for how she makes me feel. I can't get over that.
But
that love is a selfless love. It is the God-sized love. It is a love that loves because it has love to give. It doesn't want anything back. It doesn't desire any reciprocity. It doesn't want anything in return. It just loves because it can't help itself.
Okay.
Love is what it is, not really what it does. That's why John says to us, God is love.
Yes, sir.
And if you really want to understand the full definition of what God is, if you want to really dissect God and go down to the substratum of what God is, you will come to the conclusion that God does not just love, but that God is love. Come in, John, and help me understand. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Beloved, I want you to know that this God-sized love is a love that gives to those who do not deserve being given to. It's a love that cares for and gives to those who do not deserve it, because God is love. And when you speak of love from the perspective of agape, from the perspective of God-sized love, if you replace the word love with give, you get an even better understanding of the word. Here it is. For God so gave the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believeth in him should be given eternal life. And the question you got to ask is, what's in it for God? Well, there's nothing in it for him, because he's just a giving giver. Oh, beloved, I stopped by to tell you today, if we are going to be able to make disciples for Yeshua, if we're going to reach our friends, our families, our loved ones, if we going to meet people where they are and be able to employ them into discipleship and followers of Yeshua, we have to give them the message that says that God loves them. It cannot be this message of behavior modification. What do you mean, Pastor Weegar? Well, you know, the church has always been in the business of behavior modification. We always want people to stop doing this, and stop doing that, and stop eating this, and stop drinking that, and stop wearing this, and stop going there, before we tell them they are qualified to be called sons and daughters of God. But Paul says that's wrong. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, Paul is clear, but God commended his love toward us. Amen. Why we were still eating this and drinking that? I wish somebody was listening. Why? Still going here and going there? Why we were still doing this call a conference.
Pastor, we gonna preach today that people shouldn't stop doing this and doing that. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, don't put the cart before the horse. Let people know that Yahweh loves them and that He loves them in spite of themselves. And when they know that, and when they see the magnitude of His sacrifice to bring them back unto Himself, then they will realize that the way they used to walk, they won't walk like that anymore. The way they used to eat, oh, bless His name, their appetite will be changed. The way they used to drink, the things they used to wear, the places they used to go, they won't go there anymore. For the love of Christ constrains us. It turns us around. Oh, beloved, I implore you to take a walk with me this morning in the teachings of our text found in John chapter 3 and verse 16, and we will find four aspects of this God-sized love that will help us, Elder Wilson, to recognize, understand, and appreciate what it is that Yahweh has done for us. The first important aspect of this love that Yahweh has for us, as John writes, is an impressive love. Somebody say an impressive love. Look at the text, John chapter 3, verse 16, the first phrase. For God so loved the world. John uses this adverb so to describe the intensity of God's love for you and me. John said this love is an impressive love. It, God so, in spite of my drinking problem, God so, in spite of my skirt chasing problem, God so, in spite of my hormone, okay, I know I'm not in your backyard yet. God so, in spite of my backsliding problem, God so, in spite of my gossiping problem, God so, in spite of my pharisaical problem, God so loved me. This is a love that wows you. It's a love that impresses you. It's a love that is so impressive that you and I cannot really grasp it. We cannot really understand it. It is an impressive love. Somebody say an impressive love. God so loved the world. But not only is it an impressive love, it is also the second thing that John shows us in this text is it is an expressive love. Somebody say expressive love.
Expressive
love. Here it is. For God so loved the world, impressive, that He gave expressive. Who was that? That philosopher, Janet Jackson, that said, don't tell me how much you love me. What have you done for me lately? See, love must be not only impressive, Elder Jones, but it must be expressive. You can't just say you love me and you haven't taken me to dinner. Yeah, you can't say you love me and you haven't paid the bills.
it an impressive love. Not only is it an expressive love, but the third thing that John shows us in the teachings of our text is that it is an inclusive love. Oh, I don't know about you, but this is the part of the passage that I like. It says that whosoever. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's talking about me. I know you with your holy self. I know you never sinned before. I know you never had any covetous spirit. I know you don't lie. I know you love everybody, even the people that stab you in the back. I know you treat everybody, but I ain't there yet. I'm still struggling to be there, but I thank God that he hasn't ripped me off. That he hasn't left me out. This love is an all-inclusive love. He says, whosoever the drunk, whosoever the prostitute, whosoever the gay, the lesbian, the transvestite, whosoever the liar, the cheat, whosoever the sucker,
shall not perish, but have everlasting.
altar in the river on the bank. You know, when I was young, we used to play that game. You know, Elder Wilson, you know, you go in a circle. You say, in the river. On the bank. In the river, on the bank. And the person gets stuck in the river. And we do that stuff with Christianity. We put a burden on people that God has lifted because they make mistakes. And we equip them to their mistakes instead of to what God has done for them. Oh, I wish somebody would say that. Sister Johnson, I said, are you saved? And these people been in the church all their lives. Well, when Jesus comes, no, that's not what I'm asking. Are you saved? Well, I'm praying. That, no, baby. Now, turn to your neighbor and say, answer the question. Either, beloved, you are saved or you are not. Because when Jesus comes again, he's not coming to save people. He's coming to evacuate, save people from this messed up world. You better be clear in your mind that you are saved, that you have been saved. And it's not by works of righteousness, but by his grace. For by grace are ye saved through faith. And it's not of works.
Thank you. God, you can't preach the kind of gospel, because if you do, you're giving people license to sin. No, not when they have the Holy Ghost. See, your problem is you're trying to be the Holy Ghost. And you cannot be, you will never be, so don't even try to be. See, Yahweh says, now you are my child. But it does not yet appear what you will be. But you need to believe that when he shall appear. You know, I don't know about you, but the Lord blessed me with three children. And then he blessed me with three grandchildren. And one of my grandsons, I'm not going to tell you which one, but this kid, man, he really pushes you to the brink of to show you the virtue of Christianity. I mean, if there was ever a testing room to measure your Christianity, it is when you come in the space of this kid. You know, he just, but you know, I will never lose my son.
Even more. I'm going to pray for you right now.
as you prepare to give. Those of you who are in the worship center, our deacons will be standing at one of our three exits. On your way out, you can put your tithe and your offering in the offering basket at the door. Yahweh, I pray now for that man, that woman, that boy, and that girl, God, who's making a decision to show you their gratitude and to be a partner with this ministry. God, take these offerings, these tithes, may they go to the furthering of the work of the gospel, and bless them, God, as they stand in need. We give you glory, honor, and praise in Yeshua's name.
Present you faultlessly.